Hello, young people, new creation youth. How are you guys doing? I hope you guys are doing well. We've got special guests tonight, my beautiful wife, and Ben and Kristen.
Thanks for having us.
We invited you guys today because I believe you guys have a very unique perspective of growing up, if you may, in the church and then not growing up in church. And so real shortly, they're going to give their testimony. But before, Megan's got a couple of just quick updates for us about what we're doing.
Just a reminder, we are having our Zoom meeting. So for our middle schoolers and our high schoolers, we're meeting at 7:30. And the link is posted right here in the description box and then also on our website. So if you just go to the nccoregon.com/online, the links are posted right there. So if it goes away after the end of this meeting. And then our young adults are meeting at 8:30.
And parents, and if you have not made your young person get online, get them online. Like, we need to see you. It's so very hard to pastor you and ask you how you're doing and see how you're doing if we don't get a chance to see you. And some of these, we've heard some sad stories that people are feeling very isolated and feeling very alone during these times. And there's something special about those Zoom meetings that we're able to actually touch base and see people and hang out. And so we want you there. So Ben and Kristen, can you give us a little bit of perspective of how you guys grew up so we have a little bit of a context of why you're on the show today? So let's go Ben first.
So basically, from birth, I was raised in the church. I have a Rhema background as well. My parents were pastors and then they helped them. I moved every 2 years and then they were helping church or starting a church. They went to Rhema when I was a freshman in high school. So I've always been in church, been in Brother Hagin meetings.
You were the epitome of the kid that was drugged to church. Parents
literally
made you go.
I think from when I was able to go, I was dedicated that first weekend I came to church.
You didn't get an option. Yeah. You never got hey, if you want to go, you can go.
My dad's rule is, as long as you're living in this house, you're going to church.
Wow.
Period.
Yeah, love it. And then Chris,
which is a good rule to have.
It was not a bad rule. And Kristen, and yours was a little different.
A little different. I grew up in a great family. My parents are still married today, 30-something years. I have an older sister, younger brother. And we had some struggles as a family. We went through hard times, but we had a good family, and I always knew that my parents loved me. Yeah. But it was not a Christ-centered home. And so I went to church maybe a handful of times here and there for different events and things, but it was never a relationship I had. It was never anything that affected my life. And so graduated high school, went down to U of O, sort of rebelled against the whole good girl thing I had been doing the whole time I was at home. And
So I want to pry a little bit. So today's show is really all about today's chat. I don't even know what we're calling it. Today's chat is really all about that young person who potentially feels like they are missing out on what the world has to offer. And maybe that Christian kid that grew up like you, Ben, where hey, I'm in church, but I kind of want to do, once my parents leave or once I'm allowed to go to college, I want to have some fun. And are they missing out on anything? As following Christian, and man, there's so many perspectives. You grew up, Ben, in the perfect world. But your relationship with Christ was never, or didn't get a chance to really be strong until when?
That's actually a really good question. So, which is super important, bottom line. If you don't have a relationship with Christ, you will literally fall away. Yeah. You'll literally go and do what you want to do because you're not rooted to anything. Let's take comment or I guess phrase that says, if you don't stand for anything, you fall for everything. Yeah. And literally, if you don't stand for Christ, you don't have him in your heart as a personal relationship at all, you're gone. Yeah. And basically, it slowly kind of started in youth group as I kind of got older, kind of got my car. My parents were cool with me hanging out with the church kids. But obviously, we weren't being good church kids. And just then once I was 18, you know, then offense comes in from the church.
Wow.
I was offended with everybody in the church because I was behind scenes a lot with my parents and saw the behind the scenes things.
You got burned out a little bit.
Yeah, I kind of burnt out and like whatever. The church is full of hypocrites. The whole, you know.
And that, you were one of them.
I was one of them. Exactly. Yeah. So that whole speech. And then like once I was 18, then I was gone.
Yeah.
And just kind of did that my own thing.
Was there a time where you felt like God was more real to you as a young person? Or did you feel like you were at the church but not really engaged?
You know what's crazy is, like, I was in Brother Hagin meetings.
Yeah.
Seeing the rows get laid out. Like, yeah. I was in youth. We had amazing youth camps where kids were getting healed and
wow.
all this spectacular things.
Yeah.
But, like, it was real, but it wasn't, like, real to me.
It wasn't personal.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So do you think you were you missed out because you didn't have much of a personal prayer life on your own? Was it where was that missing link that you said, this is mine? And did you ever have that moment, or was that not till way later?
Yeah, it wasn't till way later.
Wow.
I always kind of had that, like, just kind of like mm-hmm. that wall up.
Mm-hmm.
I remember a youth camp I went to at Rhema, actually, when I was a freshman. I went to their youth camp, and everybody, like literally every single person was up front laid out, and I was the only one
wow.
sitting, like purposely in my heart, like
wow.
grudgingly, for whatever dumb reason.
Yeah.
Like it was just like this weird, like,
yeah.
And I knew better.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
My parents love God, and like,
yeah.
I've been around, like, you know what I mean? I just, like, I remember that, just
yeah.
like, I'm not going up there.
Well, that can really go to show you as a young person, you can be present,
yeah.
but you cannot be present. You know, you can be here, but you cannot be engaged. And that's no different than what we've talked about before. You can walk around the gym all you want, and you will not get muscles if you are not lifting yourself, and you're not having those moments. But, babe, you were going to say something?
Yeah, I think that's just the difference between, like, being a spectator and being involved,
yeah.
being a player. And
yeah.
in church, it's the same thing. Like, we can all go to a ball game. Well, not right now. but we can go watch something or watch some kind of sporting event, and you're there and you're participating because you're there, but you're not really involved unless you're out there on the field playing
yeah,
the game.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's kind of the difference when the Spirit of God starts to move in services, at a youth camp, at a women's conference, at any of those kind of things, and you can kind of stand back and you're in the room and you're here, and by all the looks, like, you walked in the building, so everybody thinks you're one of us, but if your heart isn't engaged and you aren't participating, then that makes all the difference in the world of
yeah.
What you can receive from God and how he can change your life.
There's a learning process, I would say, to learning the voice of God and learning to kind of ebb and flow with the Spirit of God. And I just think as a young person, you have to begin to hear God's voice, and you have to begin to engage,
yeah.
and you have to begin to work with God. And that means that when he brings correction, when he brings instruction, when he brings scriptures that maybe even change, that you want to balk at, or you're like, I don't want to do it. Well, that's the time where you get a chance to grow. So, Ben, this question is kind of for you, and Kristen, you can give this perspective as well. But starting off with Ben, because I believe that sometimes there's Christians who say, there's kids who grew up in church, and they're like, I've been good, which I know that, Kristen, you even said that you related to this. I've been good this whole time. I want to live a little bit. I'm going to rebel against that, and then I'll come back to God later. What would you tell
grace,
a young
grace.
Person?
Yeah,
what
grace.
Would you tell a young person that says, I'm going to go be a little bit bad.
Yeah.
I'm going to get off my, you know, good thing just a little bit, and I'm going to go be bad for a little while.
Yeah, so I think the problem is when you start, like, dabbling in sin, and then you kind of just start opening that door a little bit. All of a sudden, you're so consumed that you didn't even know. Like, I was just kind of partied a little bit. I didn't really party. My claim to fame, I didn't really start drinking until I was 21. And then, like, then 21, you have a little bit of drinks. And all of a sudden, like, now, you know, a year later, I'm drinking a whole entire bottle.
Yeah, you battled alcoholism.
Yeah,
really?
Like, I was drinking a bottle
wow.
a day.
Yeah.
Like, it just, I was a little. And all of a sudden, like, now I'm just out of control. And the craziest thing was, like, I'd be in, like, the bars just completely gone. And I'd
wow.
feel God's love. I'd feel this weird feeling. I'm going to say feeling because we don't chase feelings. But, like, when I was back in youth group and this and that, I'd feel that presence almost still. I'd get so mad. I just like get like I want to do me. Let me do me. And I was just like it was ridiculous. And so like to dabble a little and say, oh, I just want to try it out. Like, it's never just try it out, because once like the devil can grab you, like it's just you're full blown. Like it's done.
Well, I definitely think that when the young people I've seen go that route, it just takes a lot longer. I don't think God leaves you, and I love that story. I love that testimony of God wooing you in the middle of it. I think God's faithful, even when we're faithless. But I think there is something that when you start heading that way, you'll end up going a lot further than you ever expected. And it's not that God doesn't take you back. It's that you sometimes don't feel like coming back. And that is a sad case, I would say. So, Kristen, maybe you can expound a little bit about for the young lady who says, I just want to be bad for a little while. Mm-hmm. And what would you tell them?
Yeah, I think it's just like sin, right? It's all an illusion. And so all of those things that you might be thinking that you're escaping the church to go find, escaping God to go find, it's not going to satisfy you. So if you're leaving the church to go get affirmation, to go get value, to find self-worth, to find just your purpose or even happiness or peace or, you know, like all of those things that we think I can't find that here for whatever reason. So I'm going to go out in the world and I'm going to date around and I'm going to go maybe chase the business world. Maybe it's academics. Maybe it's drugs or alcohol, all those things, like they're all empty. And once you think that you have reached it, it's not going to satisfy you. It satisfies maybe for a moment, and then you wake up hungover. You wake up miserable, regretting your choices. And so no matter what you think you're going to get out in the world, it's nothing apart from Christ. And so if you think you're getting happiness, it's temporary, it's fleeting, it can't sustain you. Yeah. And there's, as much as I lived the worldly life in college once I left high school, my life has never been more full than it's been since I've been in church serving God. Wow. And I can't, there's nothing that compares. And I think just that statement, the way you asked that question, which I've heard that, and I, to be honest, like, I think maybe all of us have maybe questioned our faith at one time, especially maybe in the beginning, but that's such a much more dangerous question than I think you even realize, because like Pastor always talks about, God's blessing, it's like the umbrella, and when we stay under it, he can protect us, is a big one. And so when you choose to walk your own path and step out from under that, you, tomorrow's not promised, and you might not have that chance to repent at the last second, and you may come face to face with eternity a lot sooner than you thought you would. And so I think that's just, it's a really dangerous place, and it's not going to satisfy you like God can.
Well, it's just like Pastor always says, sin will take you farther than you want to go, cost you more than you want to pay, whatever the rest of it is. All that, like, sin is worse than we think it is. And we think in our own little puny brains, because as if you're a teenager, your brains aren't finished growing yet. And so you think you're smarter than you are, and you think that you can handle more than what you can handle. And you're like, oh, you know, just a little drink, just a little cuss word, just a little bad. And the truth is that once you start going down that road, the devil then puts his hook in and he pulls you as hard as he can. And young person, you're not strong enough. You're not strong enough to withhold that without your relationship with Christ. Christ is the thing that centers us, that keeps us grounded. So if we let go of him and go towards sin, you're not strong enough on your own. You're going to fall, and you're going to fall flat on your face, and it's going to suck. You're going to hate it. And then you're going to wake up one morning going, what did I do? How did I become this person? This isn't who I want to be.
Well, I think that we talk a lot about like drinking or partying, or, I mean, I think those are very young, natural tendencies. But also I would say being prideful and being a jerk or being addicted to lust or not being able to relate to another, or when you're a man and relating to a woman like you should be. Like all of these my soul is healthy attributes that come through Christ, these things will not be right when you're not right with Christ. And so there are way worse things than because sometimes people think, well, I'm not addicted to alcohol, I'm not addicted to drugs, I don't go party, so I'm good. That doesn't mean you're good. That just means that maybe you've been a good person, but you've not been a God person. And we want to create young people that are listening to the leading of the Holy Spirit. I don't want good kids, I want God kids. I've said that kind of from the beginning with my own children, and that's the thing. I don't want kids to just stay out of jail. Big deal. Big deal. Like that's great if you're staying out of jail. I want kids that are world changers, that can hear the voice of God, that can discern between right and wrong. Because there's a lot of things in the Bible. I mean, we know that getting drunk is a sin. But what about, you know, not taking your grocery cart all the way? Is that wrong? Like learning how to hear God's voice in such a way that he literally directs us in the littlest of things rather than like the big sins. Another kind of question for you guys, just, and Megan, actually I want you to maybe chime in on this a little bit. I got some questions.
It's gonna get real.
What would you tell a person, a young person that maybe, Ben, maybe you were it, that said, I have been dragged to church this whole time, and I'm not sure this is my decision, and I wanna find out my own way. And I'm gonna kind of make this decision on my own. And that means maybe following Christ in general, but they're saying, you know, church might not be for me. And this was my parents' thing, and they made me do it, and I'm not really in it. What would you tell that young person? So let's start with Ben. Kind of go around.
Cool.
Ready to get real.
Yeah, I think everyone has, you have to find out, for you need Christ's relationship for yourself. And for me, it just took me a really long time to, oh, hi, God. I remember just like, you know, I made those decisions to fall away and just kind of, I guess I never fall away if I never wasn't there, right? super drinking, crazy drunk. And I remember one night I was flying down the highway and I was so drunk. And I tried to kill myself. Wow. I tried to smash my car, going like 100 miles an hour into the median, like last second, turned out of it. And like that still didn't shake me.
You know what's crazy about that though, Ben? That's the devil's ultimate plan.
Yeah.
Even if you were saved and you end up going to heaven, your effect here on earth would have been cut short. And therefore, the people that you would have reached for him could have been. So that's the devil's ultimate goal. People don't think. Yeah. People think that like he wants to kill you. He literally wants to kill you. And it's amazing that sometimes these young people who begin to flirt with sin in such a way where they completely give into it, how quickly suicidal thoughts will come. Right. Yeah. How quickly different things, and how he's just, his ultimate goal, I want to kill you. And big deal, you get to go to heaven. He doesn't care that you get to go to heaven. You're not going to bring anybody else with you.
Yeah, definitely. It just breaks my heart too, of just like the looking back now of all the people that that came across my path. I mean, we moved two years. Every 2 years we moved. Wow. Different state, different city. Like all those kids and all those people that
you could have reached.
Yeah, could have reached. Could have said something like, oh, that's that Christian boy. He doesn't, you know, he's just like us. It's like, well, that's terrible. And it wasn't even until I was with Kristen that we went to my dad's church and I like tweaked my back super bad. Could barely even walk and like bend over. And the moment I stepped foot in the building, my back was completely healed. Wow. And I'm sitting there in worship, and worship was like, it's not like we have here. Let's just say that. And I'm just sitting there bawling my face off. Yeah. Like I didn't even want to be there. And like the worship was like a Western country like style like worship. Like I'm just
Jesus
like
Jesus still moves in
he
country.
He moves in country, but like I was just like I'm just my dad's like, what's going on? I was like, God healed my back.
Yeah.
Like I cursed his name. Yeah. I rebelled against him. Like he loves me so much.
Yeah.
I'm just like, and then from that moment on, it's like you gotta have to have that moment. Absolutely. Or that just like that, like God is real to me.
Yep.
It's better to find it a lot earlier than when it's here.
Absolutely. So what would you tell Kristen, that person who is not like, this isn't my decision, my parents make me come, I'm not. What would you tell them?
I think I'd say God knows your heart. He knows your thoughts. He knows that you're thinking this. He knows you're feeling these things. And you can go, I would just say, go to him and be real and be humble and be sincere. And he can handle your questions and your doubts. And, you know, I know we walk by faith, not by sight, but I don't think we're supposed to just blindly follow God. He gave us a brain for a reason.
Yeah.
And Jesus, he didn't just lay everything out super plain and clear in the Bible. He spoke in parables. He wants you to think through stuff. And so come to him with your hard questions. sins. Awesome. And I even remember maybe a year or two after being saved, and we were coming here to this church, and John 3:16, for me, it's like what the scripture that the whole gospel is based mm-hmm. on. And I just remember every time it got quoted, I had like no, to be honest, I had like no response, like no feeling, no emotion, like cool, John 3:16. And I remember getting kind of like fed up about that. And I literally was on the floor in my closet, baby's napping, he's at work. And I asked God sincerely, make this real to me, make this yeah. personal to me. How can yeah. I connect to this verse? Yeah. And it didn't take long, and no one will be surprised, but I was bawling within just a few minutes, I'm sure. And I was just, because he made it real, he spoke yeah. it to me in a way that I could relate to it as wow. a parent yeah. and also as a child. And I remember I called Ben right afterwards, and he's on a ladder on the side of a building painting, and I'm like, God sent Jesus to die for me. And it's one of those things like, he can handle real. These questions. Yeah. Yeah, just go to him with it. Yeah.
That's awesome. What would you say, babe?
Yeah, there's something about like growing up in church and knowing all the right things to say to do that doesn't make you a Christian.
Absolutely.
There's a moment where you have to decide, okay, are you going to do this or are you not going to do this? Are you going to live for God or are you not going to live for God? Do you really believe this stuff or do you not? And I remember when that time came for me, when God corrected me, I mean, I had struggled, you know, through my junior high years of, you know, I always believed in God. I never stopped believing in God or believing in faith and all those types of things. But it was like, am I going to live for him? And that was where, you know, you have one foot on this side of the fence and the other foot on this side of the fence. And you know what God says about lukewarm Christians, that he hates them. He makes them want to puke. And so when he came to me with like, okay, here's your ultimatum. You need to obey me. You need to do this now. Yeah. And then that's when it was like, that was that hard choice of like, oh, this is where the rubber meets the road. I gotta choose mm-hmm. life or death. He set before me life or death. Choose life. He's like, choose life. You know, he's telling me. And thankfully I made that decision to choose life and to follow him and obey him. And that was kind of that moment of like, okay, I'm going to actually do this thing.
Yeah.
And I think that's what I absolutely going to God and saying, if you're having those kind of questions of, do I believe this? Is this for me? Go to God. Yeah. He's the only one who can make it real to you. And that's what I've prayed for you teenagers for years and years, that the presence of God would be so strong that you wouldn't be able to deny it, that you wouldn't be able to deny God's presence in your life. And that's what I have. I have a relationship with God that I know he's so real. There's no way for me to doubt him because I know him.
Yeah.
And when I read my Bible, it comes alive because I've had that experience. And so going to him and asking him for that experience, if you haven't had that yet, you need to have a moment with God where he becomes real to you. And that's kind of different for every person. That's a different moment for every person. It doesn't happen the same for everybody. And so know that we're praying that for you.
Yeah.
So the Bible says that we pray that it's working. Yeah. And so know that it's working, but you have to open your heart to him. It can't be your parents pushing you towards something that doesn't make you live right. That doesn't make you live for God.
You know, one more thing on that with like when you say like, because you can be real with God and God wants, he's desperately longing for that, for us to have that Absolutely. Relationship for you just to say, what does this even mean? Right. Like, who are you? Mm-hmm. Like, and we can get so wrapped up in our friend, our worldly friends, mm-hmm. non-Christian friends. Well, they care about me and they got my back. Mm-hmm. You know, the funny thing is when I committed to God, my worldly friends, the one that bailed me out of jail and all those guys, they were nowhere to be found.
Wow.
Like they loved me in the gutter, but when I was finally good, they were gone. Like those are my boys. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like I was like trying to just like, well, it looks like you're good, baby, this and that. Like, and that was it. Like they were done with me.
Wow.
But all like, but we can have that moment. Yeah. The friends that are my boys that know. But then we have these moments with God that just like you feel his presence mm-hmm. wrap you up. Like mm-hmm. no other, whatever I've tried to chase in the world, like that presence alone, man, it's just unexplainable.
Yeah. So what would you tell sometimes our young people? We've heard things like, you don't understand, my parents are so strict.
I understand.
They
I understand
are
too.
So strict. You don't, it's so, babe, what would you tell a young person who says their parents are too strict?
Relish it, enjoy it. You'll be so thankful that they were strict when you grow up and have kids of your own. Let me tell you,
Kristen. Did you grow up in a strict home per se, or You feel like your parents were more strict?
Maybe middle of the road, yeah. I guess. I think my older sister really pushed the boundaries on all that, so I think they were just grateful that I wasn't as as much work as she was, and so I kind of slid under the radar with some things, which didn't go well for me, yeah. But yeah.
Strict parents, Ben. Do you know anything about that?
Yeah, I wasn't allowed to go to dances. I wasn't allowed, you know, to do any of that stuff for public schools, and so they were super strict in that in those regards too. But man, I wish they were stricter. You know what I mean? Because we got to hang out with the youth kids. The youth kids, like our group, wasn't.
Friendship.
Wasn't.
Well, that's
you're
actually,
with you're with the church kids, yeah. So it's fine. It's like no.
Yeah. Well, sometimes kids ask about Christian music versus secular music and Christian friends versus non-Christian friends. And they put these big distinctions on, okay, this is Christian music so I can listen to it. But then I was just listening to, I won't say an artist because you might be listening to him, but I was listening to this guy, dude, and this guy's all talking about depression. He's talking about thoughts of suicide. He's talking about and this is a Christian artist. And I'm like thinking to myself, this is unhealthy. This is an unhealthy music. And so sometimes people think that just because it has a label of Christian or good for you, it's almost like healthy foods. If it says it's good for you, it's healthy, most likely it is not good for you and it is not healthy. And sometimes when these Christian friends, they say, oh, they're the Christian friends, they can hang out. That just means maybe they're good at shining on. So I know, babe, you had some questions or you had some friends that were Christians. That one of them was your first cuss word.
Yeah.
I know that.
Yeah.
So
pastors' kids.
What would you tell a young person
for those pastor kids?
Have you ever had experience of Christian friends that were bad influences?
Yeah, absolutely. Just because someone claims to be a Christian or comes to church doesn't make them act right and make wise choices.
Yeah.
And so, young person, I know we've said this time and time and time again, but I'm going to tell you again. Show me your friends and I'll show you who you are. You will begin to act like your friends, period. If your friends are cussers, if yep. they're liars, if they're running to get in trouble all the time, go read Proverbs. It tells you all the time. Don't hang out with those people. That it's so stupid if we think that we can have ungodly friends and still be godly. You can't. They don't go together. They don't mix. Righteousness and unrighteousness, yeah. they don't fit. They don't work together. That's why you shouldn't be dating anyone that isn't a Christian.
Oh, can you just say that again, babe?
You shouldn't be dating anyone, period.
But what if they're really good looking?
You're not wise enough to
have a boyfriend or a girlfriend. First of all, I had a lot of Christian girlfriends in the youth group, so I don't even think you need to be dating at all. Like, no. Until you know, so you're married, like,
it's
in the youth, like,
time,
you're
right?
Just young. Like, just, yes. You know, be young. Yeah.
You
don't
enjoy
need to.
It.
You don't need to get booed up. Exactly. Like, we don't need to do that.
I don't need a boo.
We don't need to do that.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Yeah. Where do we go from here? I would say, so Ben, tell me about your experiences with Christian friends that were supposed to be good influences on you that they weren't.
Yeah, so I guess growing up in the youth group, we all kind of had secret girlfriends, and we all listened to worldly music. Wow. Like nice rap, you know, that back old school rap, yeah. Back in the day. And my parents were, because in church, we can all put on a great smile. We can quote yeah. that scripture, give the yeah. wink to the parent, like we're yeah. good to go. And yeah, so we were free to go to the movies or go, you know, hang out. And yeah, we had our own cars so we could yeah. do what we wanted to do. And
so I would say in choosing your friends, let's look for fruit. And well, what does that mean? That means fruits of righteousness. That means fruits of love. I actually, these people should have a way they talk, the way the Bible actually talks a lot about no coarse joking. Like these are the things that like a Christian should be developing. And I'm not saying everybody's batting 1,000, but there should be a evidence of this in people's yeah. life.
Because you think too, it's like, what is that? Like, if you big picture, like big, like pull back the other lens, you know, and just like, what are they really doing to your soul?
Yeah.
Like, what are they dragging you? Like, yeah. they're first of all, they're taking you more and further away from God, mm-hmm. and even like your thought of like, you know, of God, and then they're just like hardening your heart to church and everything else, and then pretty soon when you're 18, like, gone. Well, it's like, well, why? Well, it's because who are you hanging out with? You know what I mean?
Kristen, did you ever have any moments? This wasn't a prep question, so this is right raw. This is live. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Did you ever have moments where you sense God's love and God's calling you even before you were a Christian? Was there any kind of special encounters that you had? You're like, wait, and you see, are you able to look back now and see that it was God drawing, but you didn't notice it then, or you didn't take a hold of it. Did you have those experiences?
Yeah. I remember at one point, I remember the Christians in my high school and seeing them and not really, there was something intriguing, and not that they ever invited me to church or anything like that. Wow. There was something about it that was drawing me. Wow. And I remember I went and bought that book because I was super like brainy about everything. And so I went and bought that book, The Case for Christ. Because I'm like, I need an intelligent person's argument as to why the Bible can be real. And but then I got a little bit scared because I feel like I got to the point where I thought if I didn't know the truth, if I didn't fully know the truth, I can continue to live the way I want to live, and I can't be held accountable for a truth I don't know.
Wow.
And I remember just like shutting it down. But in college, even there was a time, two times I can remember, I had just ended a relationship that had gone on for like 4 or 5 years, and I was taking an art class, pass, no pass. The only requirement is don't have too many absences, and I had already hit my max, and I was like not feeling it. I was going to stay home. Like, I don't want to take this class again. And so I'm running to class, and I was crying because I had just broken up with someone. And these two people, it was completely empty because it's during class, and these two people were walking on the street, and they tried to stop me, and they said, is there anything we can pray with you about?
Wow.
And I just remember I just broke up with my boyfriend. It was like, and I just left to class. And I hope they prayed after I left. But then there was another time at work. I worked at a makeup counter at Macy's, and this woman came and sat in my chair, and I was doing her makeup. And those people are there for a while. And she started talking to me about how her husband got his fingers cut off in a chainsaw accident or something, and that they prayed and God grew his fingers back. And I remember thinking, this lady's an absolute wackadoodle, and I now have to finish her face. And now I'm like, wait, now I believe that can happen. And so it's just so interesting, like looking back at different marks of there were people on my path, and he was working even when I didn't know that it was
That's
the truth
cool.
even.
That's the goodness of God. I mean, the truth to be told is God's always drawing you. And the fact that some of you guys are even watching now, or if you're having some of these thoughts, that's God trying to intervene in your life, trying to stop you from making stupid decisions.
I think the thing too, to go back to the, if you feel like you have strict parents, I know for me, because my parents were super strict too, and we weren't allowed to do anything, felt like, you know, and they're keeping us from having fun, and all my friends at school are having fun and doing all this stuff, and I'm stuck at home and can't do anything. And so it made me want to rebel because I wanted to like be free.
Well, you felt like you were missing out on something.
Yeah, I felt like I was missing out on everything. And so, but just realize, young person, that rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft.
Yeah.
Like we just read that.
That's
in our
your
Bible.
Carnal nature trying
that's
to come out.
That's your carnal nature. That's the enemy of your soul trying to rebel against boundaries and what God has set for protection for your life. Maybe your parents are a little too strict, but you know what? Later on down the road when you're 25, you're going to be grateful for that, that you didn't go out and get messed up and get molested and raped because you were out messing around. Yeah. I mean, can we just say that for a moment? So many things happen, especially in young women's lives, because they're messing around and it literally robs
it's
them
pain.
From their life.
Yeah.
And creates scars that are so hard to get past. And if you would just enjoy the boundaries and realize that God's placed you in a Christian home and be grateful and thankful for that.
Yeah.
And grow through it, then I mean, like.
Well, the Bible talks about submitting to your parents.
Yeah.
And honoring them, and you really don't get a chance to submit until you get a chance to disagree.
Yes, yeah.
And oftentimes, young people, I've even heard stories about, my little girl was so kind until she turned into a teenager. Well, that was when they wanted to do their own thing, and you got an opportunity to submit. So honor your parents, submit to your parents. If you feel like they're being too strict, well, let God deal with them. And
wait
just kind of, and keep this moment and say, worst case scenario, we've had friends, I had an old youth pastor friend, I won't say what he is, his dad was not strict. His dad encouraged bad behavior. And he said he had no boundaries, and he grew up so fearful, and he grew up so messed up. And now he looks back and he wished somebody would have just told him, no, you can't do this. No, you can't go there. And understand that sometimes the strictness of our parents is a measure of how much they really love you.
Well, and also, yeah, that's what I was just going to say. It's I think it's one of those things that's hard for young people to grasp unless you ask God to help you. But as a parent now, I understand and I have so much more grace and appreciation for my parents.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
If you think about whether they're too strict, like beyond reason, you think, whether even if they aren't Christians, just know that every rule and every boundary, it's rooted in a desire and an intention to keep you safe and to protect you, which is rooted in love.
Yeah.
And so like you're saying, just first of all, just submit because they're your parents.
Yeah.
But also just know that they know more than you.
Yeah.
And there's a reason they're saying, no, you can't hang out with that friend or you can't do that. And so just have grace for them. And just like we're doing that love challenge. So the 1 Corinthians 13, one of the statements about love, it says love always assumes the best in one of the versions. So assume the best. Assume that your parents really do love you and really do want to keep you safe and keep you away from all those things.
Yeah, and actually, I want to talk to the parents real quick. Please be more strict. And I know that that's not young people that you might not want to hear that, but like, go ahead and regulate the music that they're listening to. Go ahead and regulate.
Look at their phone. Don't let them have this any app on their phone.
Like these things, you shouldn't get away with anything, young person. And they should check up on you. They should know where you're at. And I think sometimes parents are afraid of being too strict. They're afraid of like, my parents were really mean and I'm not going to be mean. And it's like the parent who, maybe the kid who got spanked a bunch are like, I'm never going to spank my kid. Whoa, you need to spank your kid. Anyway, that's maybe a whole different topic. But parents, go ahead and be very involved in your young person's life. You don't want any surprises, meaning you don't want find out that they were hanging out with this friend. They were doing, like, you should be very involved in your young person's life. You are not there to be their friend. You are there to be their parent. And it's just like in a workplace, you don't go and hang out with your boss and you don't go kick it with your boss because he's your boss. There needs to be a particular relationship there. And as a parent, you need to be the parent. And that means you don't need a friend. You need a parent. And they're going to have lots of friends throughout their life, but they're only going to get one parent. And so I just want to encourage you, be the parent. Tell them no. And do it with a smile. You don't have to be mean. You don't have to be rude. You don't have to be belligerent. But you do have to make some hard decisions sometimes. And that means, no, you will not do this. And I love you. And that's why. And so I know that was a free little tidbit.
Well,
okay.
Speaking to the parents then too, like if you have your son or daughter that's doing the crazy stuff, just keep praying for him.
Yeah,
my
good.
Dad and mom prayed for me constantly.
Yeah.
And my dad relentlessly invited me to church. And when I got older and out of the house, I would say, no, he's okay, son, still love you.
Yeah.
Come when you can. And then that moment that I did is when God completely wrecked my life.
Yeah.
So awesome. Just keep praying for him. Love him.
That's awesome. All right. So our last question, we got 7 more minutes here. But how would you encourage a young person to really ground their relationship in Christ at this time? How can we help them to say, hey, we want them solid. And so what advice would you give them to get solid, to not be that kind of fake Christian or not be the young person that runs away? Ultimately, what I'd like you to do is pretend you're talking to your kid right now. And say they're about to go to college or they're, what would you tell them make sure that they're grounded?
I think for me, and this goes to any adults that are watching too, I think you have to set those non-negotiables in your life. And
wow,
I think that's
good.
Key. And for me, like I've been really intentional about not only do I just want to serve God and be in church as much as I can anyway, but I've intentionally arranged my life in a way that I'm not going to fall away because I have these checkpoints of accountability. And so I'm in a small group.
Yeah.
We're leading a small group. First of all, come to church every Sunday, go to youth every Wednesday night, watch it online if that's all we have right now, but serve on a team at church. Going to women's, going to men's, there's just so many checkpoints of if I start to get lukewarm or grow cold, which we're going to, that's why the Bible tells us to stir ourselves up. If I get in that place, I have all these touch points throughout the month where I'm going to be face to face with other Christians who can call me out.
Awesome.
And I'm going to see Pastor on a Sunday and I'm going to wonder if he can read my mind right now that I didn't read my Bible this week.
He can actually
he really
read
can.
Your mind. That's a thing.
He can. And so, but then sometimes it's just that being in an atmosphere of faith that the anointing is here. year, and it stirs me up and adds that in. And so then the next day, I am reading my Bible because I want to, not because I feel like I have to. And I do want to pray. And I find that the times when I come to church because I don't want to let down my leader, or, you know, there's sometimes just practical reasons, but God honors that. And I think anytime we're in an atmosphere of faith, it spurs us on to keep that relationship strong outside of church, which is more important now than ever, right? Because you're not here face-to-face with people. Yeah. I mean, there's the Zoom, but Pastor doesn't know if you're watching the live stream on Sundays. We don't know if you're watching right now. And so it's more important than ever that we have our personal relationship with God, and that it's our responsibility. It's no one else's responsibility. Okay. So.
That's awesome. Ben, what would you tell that young person?
For sure, just get with God. Like, however long it takes, have that moment where it's just like, God, you are real.
Yeah.
And there's no, ask him about his love, his mercy, his grace, whatever you need to get your mind and heart wrapped around it, and just hold on to it. I think another thing too is look at people in the church or in your life that are doing things that maybe you want to do as well. Mm-hmm. So Pastor Nate or Pastor Brian or whoever, that's striving and going forward and not wishy-washy, mm-hmm. but be friends with them. Say hey, just, I want to be friends with you. I want to Zoom now, or I want to FaceTime, or just FaceTime me once a week, and just pick their brain and just build that relationship with someone that's going in the right direction.
Yeah.
And just keep those kind of people around you and keep accountability, I think, too. So.
I love it. Megan, what would you tell a young person?
You know, the
about
thing
to go
is,
to college?
Is that no one else can have your relationship with God for you. Your parents can't. Your friends can't. You're the only one who can have your relationship with God. And so when the end comes, when Jesus comes, the Bible says we don't know when he's going to come. He could come today. He could come tomorrow. He could come 100 years from now. We don't know. And we're to always be ready. And if that moment comes and your relationship with God isn't there, that's what matters. That's the moment that matters.
Yeah.
And so make sure you're ready. Make sure you have your own personal relationship with God so that when that time comes that you're ready and he's like, yep, enter. Well done, faithful servant. Yeah. You can enter into the joy of the Lord. That's what I want God to say to me. And so I have to live in that place that's ready. I can't have my husband do that for me. I can't have my parents do that for me, my friends. That's on me. And the same thing goes for you. That's on you. Your relationship with God is on you. So stir it up. Press into the things of God, because now more than ever, we need to know who God is for ourselves, because we don't know what could happen in another couple months and another couple years of what our freedoms are going to be like here in America. We don't know. And so we have to have that relationship with God so we can stand strong.
Yeah. Well, young person, I just want to encourage you to really take a moment, take some time this week and just get real with God. It doesn't take long. Sometimes people think, I love what Brother Hagin used to say, you should never be more than 3 days away from God, meaning you should always be in this communion with him, and it shouldn't be strange for you to talk with him, and it shouldn't be, we don't have to over-spiritualize it. You can just talk to him. You're just like, hey, what's up? And I'm really scared right now, or I'm nervous right now, or I don't know what to do right now. Yeah. That kind of honesty is beautiful. Yeah. And I think it's the beginning of a really healthy relationship rather than this, you have to hold your hand just a certain way, or I can only be on the second row at church and then God can speak to me. It's just not how it works. And now
God meets you where you're at, absolutely. Not where you pretend to be.
Absolutely.
I think because we can pretend a lot in church.
Yeah, we can shine.
But he's going to meet you in the God, I need you.
Yep. And I think it's beautiful when we just get raw and real. And that's why I'm not with as much as I want to see everybody, it should not affect the church at all. It literally should. I mean, we should assemble, but the church is strong because of our relationship with Christ, period. Our church should remain the light. Our church should remain the source of strength in our communities because our Christians are plugged in. And I would say nothing puts a stain on the name of Christ more than a Christian who's pretending to be a Christian but has no fruit, has no sweetness, has no power, has no wisdom from the Holy Spirit. And that that is, I would say, what's hurting Christianity most. But that's, I hope that it's not going to be our young people. Our young people are going to be the ones who are connected, who are engaged, and who are doing things strategically. We're going to kind of talk about that next week. But you are doing things, what God called you to do, strategically, because you know He's leading you to do it. And I really believe that'll be where we're most effective. So, amen. Well, thanks, Ben and Kristen, for joining us.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks for your guys' input. Anything else you guys want to say to young people? Parents? Come on, last little tidbit. Any put you on the spot? Anything? No.
Yeah. Just be real. Mm-hmm. Like, don't fake it till you make it. Don't. When God says multiple times, choose life. You can choose death, but choose life. He said, choose life, but choose life. You can choose it, but choose life. Just choose life.
Yeah.
Like, we love you. Awesome. Like, I don't wish that any of you would go down the path that I went on.
Absolutely.
Like, that's just a terrible. And, you know, I'm sure you say the same thing. Like, it's just choose life. We love you so much. Like, we don't want to see you guys, you know, struggle. So
that's awesome. Babe, got anything?
We love you. We believe in you. We believe that God is working in your life, and we're praying for you.
Yeah, and so we will see you on Zoom meetings.
Zoom meetings.
That's the cool thing. We will see you in 15 minutes. And so parents,
get
your kids there, or if young adults, we'll see you at 8:30. We value those times, being able to just see your face. And so love you. Farewell. We will see you next week.